Some accomplishments in life, and sometimes the most impactful ones, can only be achieved as a member of a team. A synchronized group of highly focused minds dedicated to a common goal. Particularly when that goal is one of the biggest problems facing humanity. As teams rise on day two of the World Solar Challenge, the real purpose behind this race is never far from their minds.
Climate change is a big issue in the world. We can see it in many different places. Many things are changing because of climate change. And we feel, with our solar car, we are working on the technology that can help change this.
We, of course, want to win. And that drives the team to create new technologies, technologies that are not yet on the market sometimes. And I think the beautiful thing about that is these technologies has really high potential in more sustainable mobility.
On the first day of the race, Team Twente from the Netherlands amassed a shocking lead and is starting day two 30 kilometers ahead of the pack.
We're in first place and we expected the other teams to be a bit closer to us, but I don't know what they're planning today. They might have another strategy. We'll keep doing our thing and they could keep doing their thing. And yeah, let's see.
Well, it's well voorgetankt and jullie whirling fourth here together with three other teams. There's just one team ahead, which is Twente. They're half an hour ahead, I think. But that doesn't really matter at the moment because the race is 3,000 kilometers, so. Maybe they burned up too much fuel yesterday and they're gonna run out of energy at the end, so we don't know yet.
Catching Twente may come down to each team's individual race strategy, which they spent 2 years meticulously designing and simulating.
So if you're a strategist, you are spending most of that morning in the back seat of a chase vehicle, you know, behind a whole row of computers, running last minute calculations, taking into account the day's weather forecast, which is now much more accurate.
At 8 o'clock, we do a simulation, and now we know what time we're going to arrive today and where we're going to be and at what percentage in battery.
Everything is a test of the car, but it's also a test of the team. It's a very strategic, calculated, and methodical thing.
Blue fight! Blue fight! Blue fight!
You guys are looking to come and boost it?
I hope so.
It'll be exciting today.
Good luck to you.
Thank you.
Day two is officially underway. The heat is blistering, and all the teams have their eye on Twente. Running second is Vattenfall, followed by Top Dutch. The three trailblazers are all Dutch teams. Behind them is Agoria, Sonnewagen, and then Michigan. But not everyone is off to such a good start.
I'm asking you, what do you want me to do? I can't fix it here.
Western Sydney has been having trouble since the beginning of the race.
We're just not sure at the moment. The mech team's having a look. There was something sounding funny, so we had to stop.
Yeah, no!
Day two, the race didn't go as planned. After charging, we ended up realizing there was a big software glitch in the car.
What seems like a simple software issue could take all day to fix. With hours of delay ahead, it's safe to say Western Sydney is out of the running to win this race.
We had a lot of ups and downs, but we all know as a team and myself know that that car is one of the top ones out on the grid, and just unfortunately this time it didn't kind of work out. But there's multiple other races coming up and maybe we can make it work there.
Mijn GPS heeft een vreemd kompas.
We're heading to Tennant Creek right now. It's a 322 kilometer drive, I think. And then it's back toward Barrow Creek. That's not a control stop.
Out on the road, the teams continue to make strategic decisions based on constantly evolving conditions.
When we're out in the outback, we're always watching the weather because the sun is the most important thing. That's what we want to be at all times. So we have a car that gets in a satellite feed with the weather. And for example, we can see, oh, there's a cloud coming in. Well, what will we do now? Will we slow down to not waste too much energy? or will we speed up to get out of the cloud as fast as possible? That's strategic decisions we have to make every time.
At the heart of every team's strategy is energy management, a constant juggling act between the car's solar panels, the battery, and the motor that propels it down the road. In a perfect world, the cars use the sun's energy alone to maintain their speed. This is called running energy neutral.
There is always a certain speed during the race where we take in exactly as much energy as we're using. So the solar panels brings in everything. But if you want to drive faster than that, let's say to overtake another team, we have to use energy from our battery storage, which then drains the battery.
Teams will tap into the battery for a variety of reasons, including a dip in the sun's energy from cloud cover, fighting headwinds, or simply making up time in the race. But it always comes at a cost.
Our number one concern strategically is that we can run out of battery power because then we have to stop right then and there and charge a car.
So you're always trying to balance. You're always trying to use the energy in the best way that you possibly can to get you to the finish line as fast as you can.
One of the biggest drains on the car's batteries comes from overtaking other teams, making passing one of the most critical strategic maneuvers of the race.
Topdutch momenteel Odo 6-7-7, set point 95 over.
And it isn't long before Agoria is knocking on Top Dutch's door.
If you have to increase your speed in order to overtake someone, you're losing energy, you're going faster than you want to be. And so teams will generally, you know, pass each other at a crawl, and sometimes that can get kind of dangerous. So it's very important that procedurally that everyone is watching for oncoming traffic, and that your lead vehicle is in the right place at the right time, in order to make sure that happens as safely and smoothly as possible.
We are driving behind Top Dutch right now. They are driving at 95 kilometers per hour. We will drive 100 kilometers per hour, so we'll gonna overtake them. That's really nice.
Nog steeds geen tegenliggers over.
He's passing.
Proficiat.
Een van de Hollanders.
En de radiostilte is opgeheven.
Yeah, we just overtook Top Dutch. They were third in the race. So now, at the moment, we are third.
We are here at Tennant Creek. This is the first stop of the second day. We are now nearly 1,000 kilometers away from Darwin. That is one third of the distance to Adelaide. Control stops are mandatory checkpoints along the route. All teams must punch in and out for a 30-minute break, and for safety, change drivers. So far, the story has been the team Twente. They've pulled out to an enormous lead on day one. They were ahead by half an hour, and now is trying to maintain that lead. There is the arrival of the team Twente vehicle, the first car to arrive here in Tennant Creek. So I'm wondering if there's something about the stability of the cars or just their solar panels, something about the way they're designed that is leading to this advantage. Vattenfall has arrived. I have to say, I wasn't expecting to see them this quickly. How did you feel about the way the car was driving?
Occasionally we're doing 100 plus kilometers an hour and we're energy neutral. That's an amazing feeling to experience.
That's extraordinary. Agoria, the team from Belgium, is in next.
It's very important for our team to prepare our control stops as good as possible.
Gordel uit, Hanterman.
Because in 2017, the difference between the fourth and the third position was only 7 minutes.
All right, guys.
There are 250 kilometers until the next control stop. What you can see up here is the team Twente is getting their ballast ready. They're getting ready to jump back in the car, whereas Agoria has basically just arrived. So there's maybe 25 minutes separating these teams. That gap is narrower than it was yesterday. So it really looks like the things are tightening up at the front of the race. One unique component of Takai's strategy is that they have an interchangeable motor, one for high speeds and one for low speeds when they need more acceleration. This gives them the ability to adapt their gearing from day to day.
Last day that we changed the motor to the high speed motor. So maybe then we can catch the Michigan the next session.
Perhaps the most spirited battle is going on in the fourth and fifth positions. As they predicted, Team Tokai from Japan has closed the gap on Michigan from the US. It can take hours to plan and achieve a pass in this race, and Tokai has had their eye on Michigan all day. With the traffic finally clear, the Japanese team makes their move. Tokai accelerates through what seems to be an effortless pass and continues far out of Michigan's line of sight. Holding on to considerable speed, a quarter mile up the road, Tokai has approached the Michigan lead convoy car, looking to pass.
One car is coming. He's coming.
Thank you.
Now, all convoy vehicles are required to give way to any solar car looking to pass.
Okay, running right side, thank you.
But the Michigan vehicle is picking up its speed.
Looks like he's intentionally doing that.
Yeah. Make space for a solar car, copy.
And now, approaching a stretch of no passing zone, Michigan slows way down, impeding Tokai while they cannot safely or legally pass. Once clear of the no-passing zone, Tokai tries again. But the Michigan car speeds up once more, not allowing the solar car to get around.
Wait.
Oh, it's about to have a head on.
You!
Tokai finally has to surrender to oncoming traffic and tuck back into their lane.
That up, man.
And the game repeats, allowing the Michigan solar car to recoup all the distance that Tokai had pulled ahead.
Okay, this guy's gonna pass.
I'm not too sure if this fits into either the rules or the ethics of this race. That will be up to Tokai and the race officials.
Whew, it is hot here in Barrow Creek at the second checkpoint for day two. And what's remarkable to me is just how much Twente has been able to maintain its advantage over these other cars. You know, on day one, they could have been bluffing. They could have been draining their battery to go extra fast. But towards the end of day two, it's hard to believe that they can still be bluffing on battery. I gotta believe that Vattenfall and Agoria are trying as hard as they can to pull back that lead. Vattenfall is second to arrive here, and by the looks of things, it's just on time. Basically, they are holding Twente's lead. It's so important for these teams to get that solar panel positioned exactly correct so they're getting the best angle on the sun and maximizing the juice that they can recover during this stop.
Lager, stop!
I'm the operation manager, and during the race, I am the one who will guide our solar car into the control stop.
We know at what time we will be at the control stop. Based on the hours that we will be there and that we think our solar car will be there, I can check the angle of the sun with our tool. I can try to position the car as optimal as possible to gain the most out of our charge at the control stop.
It is incredibly impressive to see these guys run out in their socked feet to hit that button. Every tiny edge is what's gonna make the difference who wins this race.
We just hit the bottom of the car, we just hit a little bit of the ground, so we just have to fill it up this evening and get it back smooth.
Much to my surprise, Sonnewagen is arriving fourth, in front of Tokai and Michigan, That episode on the road might have helped the German team catch and pass them both.
On the last 40 kilometers up here, we managed to overtake both of them. So we're now in a good position, place four, to leave Barrow Creek and end the day somewhere between Barrow Creek and other springs.
Tokai is here, with Michigan right on their heels. It just isn't Tokai's day, as they get hung up getting the car situated. And Michigan gets to the button before them.
As we came into this control stop here at Barrow Creek, Tokai pulled in ahead of us, but they had to turn around and line up to point to the left, whereas we could just pull straight in, point to the right, and now we're in front of them for free, meaning that we're back in the driver's seat, and if they want to have to pass us again, they're going to have to build up and waste the energy to do so.
On top of the seconds lost getting punched in, Sid, the driver for Tokai, is not exactly happy with how that last leg went down.
It's intense for more than a second, better part of an hour. I tried to pass a few times, I just had to keep giving up. I'm fine to battle with other solar cars on a battery gas-powered vehicle, so that's when I get a little upset. It's pretty scary for me.
They are assured a review with the officials, but they still have a race to run, and it's a long way to Adelaide. As teams get back on the road, the intensity is definitely picking up. You can feel it.
I think we were 5 to 6 cars here, which means it's super close, super exciting. We're 5 minutes from the second place, and it seems like we put some pressure on them still today, so looking good. And we're gaining on the first place as well today, so good day.
When the official stop down time comes at 5 p.m., the top five teams are all holding their positions, maintaining a blistering pace.
There's some bad weather expected tomorrow. The high headwinds will slow down the solar car, so it'll cause us to drain the battery, use more power. So maybe some teams are burning a little hot to beat the weather and get out in front of it.
As the second day of the World Solar Challenge comes to a close, the story is still Team Twente from the Netherlands. With the smallest car in the race, they are comfortably out in front, looking almost flawless.
It's been another great day, and you guys have shown again that you are a formidable team out there. Very difficult to catch, and just growing this lead.
Yes, we're really happy about that process. We're progress. It's really cool to see. I've been working for more than a year on this project, and well, now you finally see your car performing as you maybe even better than you expected it to do. So, yeah, really glad about today.
That's got to be really rewarding.
Yes, it really is. It really is.
So every night at 8 o'clock, we go live to Belgium on our Facebook page to show all our supporters how we're doing in the race.
Just show the people in Belgium what we're doing and why what we're doing is important for the future and for renewable energy overall. Yeah, we're now focusing on high school kids because they show a lot of interest in terms of technology and the future and the importance of it all for the race.
As night falls, the wind starts picking up. And what's interesting to me is the weather is forecast to get even worse tomorrow. So if we get wind and cloud cover over these cars, well, it could change everything. Strengths can turn into weaknesses and vice versa. If I had to guess, I'd say day 3 might bring some mayhem to this race.